Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about IUI. The full form of IUI is intrauterine insemination. So we will be discussing in this video what is IUI, what are the indications, that is when it should be done, what is the process, what are the drawbacks, and what is the success rate of IUI. So intrauterine insemination has been done from long time. And there are patients who come to us who have intrauterine insemination done and it has failed many times and it has been repeatedly done. And the patients think that this process is a mild process. It comes before IVF. And sometimes we get patients and they come and tell us, the doctor, I want to do IUI even when IVF is advisable. So first of all, we should understand that IUI is a simple process. Yes, it comes before IVF. But it is not a substitute for IVF. So that means that if patients come to us and say, doctor, we don't want to do IVF, but you can do IUI. We don't agree to that. We don't think that it should be done in such cases where IVF is indicated. However, if we look at the indications of IUI, IUI can be done if patient has mild male factor. Mild male factor means there is a problem with the count and motility and in the volume of the sperm, but it is mild. Little bit of defect in the semen analysis can be compensated with IUI. If there is a sexual dysfunction, that is the couple is unable to try naturally, or if it the patient has unexplained infertility, or if we feel that the cervix is not a very good place for the sperms to move up. So patients who come to us, we clearly tell them the indications of IUI are this, and this is the case where we will do IUI, and this is the case where we will not do IUI. So it should be very clear that IUI should be done in clearly selected patients. Now, the success rate of IUI is quite close to the success rate of a natural cycle, because in IUI also, the pregnancy is going to happen by the natural mechanism. So what is going to happen in IUI is that we will give our patient, the patient will come on second day of periods. We will give them some oral drugs or injectables to make their eggs, which are 1 to 2 in number. Then we are going to give injection to rupture the eggs, which will happen around 11th, 12th, 13th day of cycle. Then after the egg rupture, injection has been given. After 36 hours, we will do IUI. So what we are going to do in IUI, we are going to take sample of the husband, then we are going to prepare it in the lab. So what we are going to do in the lab is that the sample will be concentrated, the sperms will be concentrated in very small amounts of the media. And this sample is, this media is going to be released inside the uterus very close to the ovaries. So we will give a physical advantage of putting high concentration of sperms the close to the where the tubes open inside the uterus, so that the sperms don't have to travel that far and more quantity of sperms are present at a higher level rather than lying at a lower level. So the preparation of the semen sample is done in the laboratory. Another factor is that by preparing the semen sample, only the sperms are suspended in the media, whereas semen has lot of other substances which are not good for the body, for the for us to put inside the uterus. So this the sample is cleaned nicely, all the other cells are removed and only the sperms are suspended in the media. So this is what we are going to do. Then it will be a simple process. The sperms are prepared in the laboratory, and then while we are going to transfer the sperms, we'll put in an instrument and then we'll put a catheter and we'll release the sperms inside the uterus. So the process starts from second day of periods and is completed in about 14-15 days. The number of visits are 4 to 5. That is initially for the ovulation scan. That is the patient comes and then we keep on checking the egg, the size of the follicle, and then once it is ready, we give trigger injection, and after 36 hours, we put the sperm inside the uterus. So the process is quite simple, but the number of visits are 4 to 5 in number. However, like natural pregnancy happens, the tubes have to be open, the tubes have to pick up the egg, the sperms have to reach inside the tube, and the sperms have to themselves go inside the egg and fertilize the egg and form a baby. And then the baby has to come inside the uterus and implant inside the uterus. So all this that happens naturally has to happen in IUI also. So the prerequisites for IUI is that the tubes should be pitted. Now, many a times the patient is not very interested, or sometimes the tubes have not been tested before, and the patient says that, doctor, just do IUI, don't check the tubes. The problem is, when IUI fails, most of the times doctors don't have any answer to give why the IUI has failed, because most of the things are not known to us. What is known to us? Yes, egg is being formed. Yes, the follicle has ruptured. Yes, the sperms have reached inside the uterus. And yes, the timings are correct. However, we cannot say after an IUI has failed as to what could have been the reason why this has failed, just like in natural conception, whether the tube failed to pick up the egg, whether the sperms did not reach the eggs in the tube, whether the sperms did not enter the egg, whether the embryo was not formed, whether the egg and the sperm did not meet, or whether the embryos did not come and implant inside the uterus. So the answers that we are unable to give in a natural conception, they remain the same in IUI also. If the IUI fails, the doctor is unable to give many answers as to why the IUI has failed. However, IUI done in selected cases, in clearly indicated cases, gives higher chances of success than if it is done just blindly on anyone. Then, even in patients where the tubes have not been checked, if the doctor is unable to give a reply, and then the doctor says that, yes, okay, maybe your tubes could have been blocked, then after having spent the money on IUI and we check the tubes later, it causes a little bit of heartburn and mistrust between the doctor and the patient. So it is always a good practice point that the tubes should be patent before we decide to do IUI in any patient. Then coming to the success rate, of IUI is about 15% to 20%. And sometimes it's even 10 to 15% in patients who are having a higher age group. Then secondly, patients who have unexplained infertility and their age is on a higher side, like 35 plus, who have a low AMH, their chances of IVF are also less. Their chances of IUI are also less because there is a doubt that their egg quality might not be that good. However, if the patient wants to start from IUI, it's not a problem. But the patient should clearly know what to expect out of IUI. The problem is that once IUI is done and it fails, if more promises have been done or the patient does not clearly know what is the process, how much chances of success, it causes a lot of heartburn that, you know, a process was done and it failed and the patients become demoralized and depressed. So another important thing in case of IUI is that the patient should clearly know what are my chances of success. So let us say if the chances of success are 10 to 15%, then that means if we do IUI on maybe 6 to 10 patients, one will conceive. So if the patient does IUI with that kind of mindset that yes, it might work, it might not work, then it is better than if it has not been clearly told before an IUI, what are your chances of success? Then they might think, a patient as a layman might think that this might be giving me 50% chances, 80% chances. They don't know about it. So every patient who starts an IUI process or IVF process should clearly know what are the chances of success, what are the indications, whether I meet the indications, not that just IUI was done blind. Next step is that we should know about the process, and then we should also the patient should also know about the chances of success. Along with that, many patients start doing bed rest after IUI. IUI is just a process wherein after the sperms have been put, it is equivalent to a natural pregnancy. So we don't recommend our patients to do any kind of bed rest or stop any kind of their routine activities or avoid any kind of travel. Or we just tell them that it's just like natural conception. And once the process is done, they're free to go home, do whatever they feel like. We never tell them to avoid intercourse or any other instructions are not given to the patient. Then most of the times there are not many complications. However, on the day of IUI, some patients have pain abdomen. And this pain abdomen could be because of two reasons. The first reason is that because the egg ruptures, there is some kind of pain. And because once we have put the sperms inside the uterus, the patient might have little bit of cramping. So once the IUI process has been done, then we put the patient on some kind of medication for 15 days. And after stopping the medication, we tell them to wait for a week or so, or on the date of their missed period, 1 week of their missed period, we tell them to check for pregnancy. Once IUI has not worked, then we tell the patient to again come back on day 2 for the next plan. So how many IUIs should one do, or how many IUIs are safe for a patient. So we usually tell our patients that 2 to 3 is the number. If the IUI has not worked for 2 to 3 times, it is unlikely to work in the future. So any patient who has done 2 to 3 IUIs and these IUIs have failed, then it is unlikely that IUIs will work. So we should move to the next plan. Secondly, patients who have done IUI, who want to do IUI, sometimes ask us, the doctor, is the process painful? The process is not painful. It is a very simple process. It's a OPD process. And one, the rapport of the doctor and the patient and the instructions given by the doctor and the instructions followed by the patient do matter. However, usually it is kind of a painless procedure. So let us come back to, we will recapitulate the process of IUI. So in this video, we have discussed about what is IUI, what is the process of IUI, how it is done, what are the indications, when it should be done, then what are the instructions after IUI has been done, and then finally, what are the chances of success of IUI, and how many cycles of IUI should one do before one moves on to the next process. So I hope with this video, one has understood the process of IUI in detail. And if you have any questions, you can put your questions in the comment section. I will be happy to reply. Thank you very much.